I'd climb every mountain and swim every ocean just to be with you and fix what I've broken.
Are you excited to be here? I'm excited about what Pastor Charity said about it being a covenant. I think sometimes we forget that this is an unbreakable bond that we made in front of a pastor or justice of the peace or whoever, that this is a covenant, and it's sealed in blood.
Yes.
Glory to God. So I'm excited you're here because I know that you're here because you want your marriage to be better.
Yeah.
And don't we all?
Yeah.
I mean, we've been married, what, 43 years?
43 years yesterday.
43 years yesterday.
43 glorious years.
Yes. 43 glorious years.
Some days not so glorious, but all the years have been glorious.
And I think that's what could be said with everybody. You know, some days glorious, some days not. But we press through. Amen.
Absolutely.
We press through. So I pray you have something to write with. I have some voluminous notes.
Voluminous.
And we're going to be here a while. No, I'm just kidding. But did you get babysitters or do we have childcare? What do we have?
No.
They have childcare. They got their own, whatever. Anyway, it's date night, so you can stay out as late as you want.
Absolutely.
You have my permission. Okay, so just like the song said, we're going to fix what is broken. Now, something may not be broken, but it could need some tweaking. Do you understand? And so that's what we're going to focus on tonight.
Yes, Lord.
You know, we need to be encouraged with the Word. And that's where we always go back to, the Word. Matthew 19:26 says, with God, all things are possible.
Hallelujah.
So you may be in here tonight and you may be thinking that this is really broke and it's irreparable. But I'm telling you, with God, all things are possible. And even if it just needs a little tweaking every now and then, God is well able to put it back together and make it the victorious marriage that I know you all want.
Amen.
We all want to have a good marriage. So the Holy Spirit will help you. And that's one thing you have to understand. You're not in this alone. The Holy Spirit will help you with the tweaking or putting back together. And I really believe that there's one area that all marriages really over the years in our counseling and just in us.
In our marriage.
Needs some tweaking in or some improvement is communication. So that's what we're going to talk about tonight during this time that I have. And then Pastor Charity and Greg are going to come up with some great message. But I just want to tell you that after 43 years of marriage, we're still learning how to communicate.
Yeah.
You know, I think I've shared this with you, but it bears repeating. A couple of months ago, which was during 42nd year, I found out that his favorite meal was breakfast. Now, that's kind of something that you might have learned maybe in the 20th year or the 25th year, but I learned it in the 42nd year. So you never said that. You never shared that with
me.
Yes, I am positive.
I thought it was me that doesn't pay attention.
I do pay really attention. We don't need to share our faults right now.
Oh.
We're trying to help other people with theirs.
These aren't faults. These are just minor issues.
Okay, but I did say that. I did say that. But I just want you to know that you never said that. And so when you said it, I went, oh, I'm going to remember this. So.
Oh. Your remembering it would be not near as important as you putting some action behind that. You know, like, you know.
I can call Marinas for a burrito and fix that breakfast that he likes. Who likes Marinas? Yes, praise God. So the Holy Spirit is going to help us with any area that is broken. So I want us to take a look at our handout. And this is a very valuable piece of paper. And I don't want you to not keep this. So I don't want it left on the
parking lot.
Parking lot or on the floor like the kids do. So you need to have a pen, something to write with right now. If you don't, they're in the seat pockets. So what we're going to look at is this first little exercise, and we're not going to take a whole lot of time because we do not have all night. But one thing I want you to do, looking at your paper, you see the heart, and you see it says my love tank. And then to the right, you have the gas dispenser. And it says, is your love tank full or empty? So what I want you to do, and everybody needs to do this. Don't just rely on your wife to do this. Everybody has a paper. So what I want you to do, I know your tricks, guys. You just let your wife do it. But what you're going to do is, in fact, you need to put your name on the paper, because that way it will help us be on point here.
Are you going to carry them? Are you going to collect them after?
No. Okay. This is for you, but just so your wife knows that you filled it out. Okay, so what you're going to do is you're going to color in how full your love tank is. Now, your love tank may not have very much in it. It may be blank, or it may be half full, or it may be all the way full. If it's all the way full, then we'll sit down and you come up here and teach the class. But really, what I want you to do is just go ahead.
If your tank's totally full, you can fix my breakfast.
I wasn't paying attention to what you said right then, because I'm trying to instruct them.
I understand.
So,
it's okay.
So do you understand, fill in with your pen?
Yes.
I should have given you colors. That would have been more helpful. So, okay. It shouldn't take very long, but I know it's a big heart. So if you're way on up there, you need to color a lot. You got it? Okay. I believe you do. You can still color if you still need some time. So we're going to go to the next little exercise, and it's on the second half of the page. And so what you're going to do now, you're going to have to listen very closely. So I'm going to talk to the men first, or the husband first, okay? The husband first. So what you're going to do is you're going to look at these husbands' needs, and they are sex, support, admiration, respect, good listener, needed, and encouragement. So these are the things you need. You need a good listener. You need to be needed. You need encouragement. You need admiration and respect. You need support, and you need sex. Now, if you have other things that aren't on this list that are really your top five, you can add them at the bottom. Okay, I just came up with these six. So what you're going to do, men, are you listening? You're going to put a one next to the number one priority. So if your number one priority in your relationship with your wife is sex, then you will put a one next to sex. Does that make sense? And then your second priority may be you want to be needed. So then you'll put a two next to needed. Does that make sense? Okay. Then, men, listen. You're going to go to the right side of the paper, and you're going to write down what you think your wife's top five are. And no peeking. Don't check her sheet. You just write down what you think her top five are. Okay.
How come there's not sex in that second row over there? Lord have mercy.
You can add anything.
How are we going to get people together if you don't have sex on both sides?
Affection is on there.
Oh, affection.
You can put slash sex, but there's a difference, you know. Okay, so ladies, wives, you're going to go to the right side of the page, and you're going to do the same thing. You're going to write down your number one priority with your husband, number two, number three, number four, number five. Now, don't peek at what one another is doing, okay? If you have additional ones or one that you don't like any of mine, then you can add them at the bottom. But you're only going to put a one, a two, a three, or four, or five in that order. Top priority, second, third, fourth, and fifth. Do you understand? And then, ladies, you're going to go to your husband's side, and you're going to put down what you think is his priorities. So we don't need to spend a whole lot of time. I mean, normally if you, the first thing that comes to mind is really truth. So use those.
Oh, man. I think we will collect these. I think we'll collect these. Be sure and put your names on them if you would. I've got a little spare time. I'm thinking about writing another book. You can be a part of a novel.
Okay, are y'all through? Anybody still need more time? Okay, I think you're through. Okay, so
I think you're through.
you're through. Let me just explain the affection on the wife side for you men. Affection is also sex, but affection is a little bit different than sex sometimes. You know, just holding the hand, just a little touch, just a little hug, just a little kind word. Those kind of things will make the sex part better. So figure it out. Okay. Now, I was going to say something else, but I'm not going
to
say it.
You want me to say it for you?
No. Let's just pass on that because we don't have a whole lot of time. But I want you to recall when you were first dating. When you were first dating, and I want you to remember how you focused on each other. You spent a lot of time with each other. You made excuses to get together, to do anything, any kind of activity, just so you could be together. Now, don't be looking at each other's while I'm doing this. You have an assignment. When you get home, what you need to do is discuss this. Not now. You can't discuss. Not right now. You're not going to compare it right now. This is not the time for it. This is a class on communication.
Yeah,
this. So you're going to communicate in the privacy of your home. And if the men have some affection, they might have some sex later on. You understand?
We don't want to distract you even before we have hors d'oeuvres and things.
That's right. Okay. So getting back to thinking back when you were dating and you thought the world of each other and you wanted to spend more time, not that you don't now, but I'm just saying,
of course, yeah.
Remember that you wanted to get to know each other thoroughly. You spent hours and hours on the phone, and then you wanted to tell the person how much you cared for them, and they told you how much they cared for you. You know, that was the way it was. That's a good goal to have right now.
Absolutely.
Like, that doesn't need to be, oh, that was the way it was. No, that should be a goal every single day.
Amen.
You need to spend time with one another. I remember I lived in El Paso. Pastor Dean was here. He would send me love letters. I still have those love letters. Yes. It was so sweet. And then
I used to write a lot of poetry, but you'd never read it.
Yeah, I don't care for that. But but he would come home on the weekends, and we would figure out how we could spend time together, spend a lot of time on the phone, talking. And you see, getting to know one another is still an important thing for
Absolutely.
You to do. Just like you might find out that your husband's favorite meal is breakfast. You know, you might find that
I'll
out
come
now.
To your house.
Okay.
I'll have breakfast with your husband.
So this should be your goal. This should be your goal. If you need to write that down, you need to write it down. This is something that you need to have conversation. You need to get to know them thoroughly. Well, you think you know them. Well, you don't. After 43 years, I still don't know him. He comes up with some garbage and some stuff that I would have never thought. So I'm telling you from experience, you don't know that person. It's a continual, lifelong process. Now, see, if you really want a fulfilling, a happy marriage, then what you need to do is you need to have this as your lifelong goal, to communicate one with another. Because so many marriages are ending in divorce. I know, because people are unhappy, they're not fulfilled, whatever, they're frustrated, they have unmet expectations. And so we don't want to be in that position. We want to communicate so that we know one another, we know what makes one another tick. And I really believe that this is the problem in a lot of marriages, and it needs to be improved upon. What needs to be communicated are things that are important to you and things that are important to him. Now, you see, sometimes men don't like to communicate, so you have to ask the proper questions. That's why, ladies, you need to have the help of the Holy Spirit. Help me, Holy Spirit. Help me to get through to this thick-skulled head. You know, sometimes you have to do those things, and maybe it's the other way around. Maybe you're the woman with the thick skull. I don't know. But you want to communicate. You want to...
Well, you just being affectionate with me?
I was being
okay,
affectionate. Yeah, that's called affection. That
Thank
is
you
not
so much.
Sex.
I
that
appreciate
is affection.
That.
Okay. So, now I have a suggestion for you, and you can turn your paper over, and that way you won't be looking at those things. But in the heart in the upper left, what we're going to do is we're going to fill your love tank. Because some of you may not be full. And so my suggestion is, at the top, you can read it. Spend 15 hours, read it with me. Spend 15 hours a week giving each other undivided attention. 15 hours. That's right. I said 15 hours. Okay.
15 horas.
Yes. And you might say, I've got a job to do, you men, or you women. I've got a job to do. I've got things to do, as Charity said when she was little. I've got things to do, too. Well, we know you have things to do. But if your job is more important than your relationship with your spouse, then you need to find another job. And what I'm telling you is, you know, God wants to bless you. He wants you to make money.
Absolutely.
But if you spend all your time working and on the job and working to have, you know, the best cars, the best house, the best clothes, whatever, think about it. If you don't have a loving wife, if she leaves you and takes the kids, then you got a problem. So you need to adjust your priorities. So if you're working too much, then you need to make some changes. Listen to this. Money or a career serve a marriage. A marriage should never serve money or a career.
That's so good. Yeah.
So think about that. You do have time to devote to your marriage. You know, I know when you get married, then you have kids, then you have responsibilities, then you have all kinds of stuff, and you don't think you have 15 hours. But let me tell you, 15 hours is the minimum that you need to spend in uninterrupted, undivided attention with your spouse.
You know what I was just thinking? If you were to fix breakfast every morning,
that would be an hour.
Well, then, no, 30 minutes.
It would take me an hour
To fix it.
Or to call Marina. Get in the car and go down.
I was just thinking that would give us 30 minutes together to visit. 30 times what? 7. What is that? 3.5 hours? Isn't that 3.5 hours a week just in breakfast? Just in breakfast.
Just in breakfast, yes.
You know, so.
Or if you cook dinner. Or,
oh, God Almighty.
See, let me tell you.
You knock out the whole 15 in 2 meals a day.
Well, that's a thought. For them,
no,
I'm not going to do it.
No, that's not a thought. That's a suggestion.
Okay, I'll make a note.
You have to take the ink out first.
Oh, okay.
There you go.
Make a note. Because I want to improve our mix. Now, if I fixed him breakfast every day, he wouldn't eat it. You know, I'm just telling you the truth. He wouldn't eat it. And if I fixed him dinner every night, he wouldn't eat it either. That's why I stopped. Because I would cook this big meal, put it in front of him. Oh, I'm not eating tonight. So that's the last time I said, forget you. But if you want to do that now, I made a note.
Do you remember, when you watched that commercial that I did when I was at my fighting weight?
Yeah, you were fat.
I was about 250. Yeah.
We went to a drive-in, and there was a commercial on the drive-in, and there was a man, they were advertising Jean Horneau's mobile, and there was a man opening the car door for a lady advertising this car. And he said, that's me. And I went, huh? I said, well, if that was you now, I wouldn't be here. But anyway, we've got
she
to go
no,
on.
No appreciation for my personality. She was, she's all about visual appearance, you know what I'm saying? Was not even counting my, you know,
I'm going to tell you something that's going to help you men. And that is, and women too, men have a conquer mentality. And so that's what you men have to realize. Yes, you did conquer her, like she is your wife now, but that relationship still requires more conquering and more maintenance. Do you understand? You just can't forget it. You know, I told her I loved her at the altar, and what does she expect now? Me to continually tell her that? You have to get a grip. Do you understand, you men? And one of the things that I've noticed as a woman with respect to other men is they spend hours and hours talking with their friends about sports and about their video games and about their job and all this other stuff. But then their wife, they just sit there. They don't say anything with their wife. And they spend all kinds of time on video games, which, you know.
You're getting kind of nosy.
Yeah, that's not a good thing. These video games will destroy your marriage, I'm just telling you. and TV or surfing the internet. All these things are distractions from your relationship with your wife. And I believe that you have ears to hear, all of you.
Absolutely.
And you will make some adjustments. You will make some adjustments. It's not only the men that are surfing the internet and watching Pinterest all day long. I understand that. Women do that too. But we've got to make some adjustments, because this is the most important relationship aside from your relationship with the Father on earth. And so get a grip and start doing some things that you need to do. You know, I don't have my phone, but when you watch people go out to dinner, everybody has their device. There's no conversation. Everybody's, you know, it's just ridiculous.
Let me check that score.
So look at this. It says on the back what the 15 hours includes. And you can do this. It includes your time of sex. And so, you know, guys, this one isn't on sex, but it's not wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. You know, 10 minutes. You know, and you can get a lot in your 15 minutes if you'll do it right. Do you understand? Or 15 hours. Okay. But our class isn't on sex tonight. But if you want to have a private, you know, Pastor Dean and I can meet with you. Okay, then this includes your private and intimate conversation, walks, time together at a restaurant where you're talking, playing sports or other activities together, conversations in the car, in the restaurant, or on the phone, all without the kids. And this is time where you communicate, you know, without kids making noise or in the way, where you are looking at one another. Not one of you is talking and the other one is saying, yes, honey, yes. What was that score? Yes, honey. Or watching the football game. That doesn't count.
That's right.
For your 15 hours. So so just forget that. So then another way to fill your love tank is to communicate each other's needs and what you can do to meet those needs. See, you really worked hard at meeting those needs before you were married.
Wow.
And that shouldn't change. So,
you know,
what you're doing,
that really speaks volumes. I mean, just that one that one area. And those of you that have been here many years, we've talked about this a little bit every time we talk about the marriage relationship. But, you know, it's like returning to your first love.
Right.
You know, it's just like the same thing as, you know, the Spirit of God speaking about us as believers returning to our first love. It's the same thing in your marriage. Because, again, that particular time, it's like, you know, fireworks, you know, every evening, and just every time you hear their voice. And I mean, it's just, you know, amazing. And that's really where the Father wants us to stay, in our relationship with Him, as well as our relationship with each other. And honestly, especially the couples of Choose Life, I know that you get this. And I know that you understand that that's exactly what will cause the rest of your marriage be the very best part of your marriage, is returning to your first love. Sure, you know, as we, you know, the longer we're married, we come into different times and seasons. We're having to change and acclimate ourselves to ourselves, the changes in ourselves, and then do that same thing to adapt with our spouse. So it really takes that same kind of communication, instead of just drifting apart to the point where you just leave one another at their own devices, which is not a healthy thing to do. And it doesn't mean that the relationship doesn't, that you don't even stay together. It just means that you're not working together to accomplish everything God wants you to accomplish. And that's one of the things about the season we're in. The tighter you can become as a couple, the more focused you can become, realizing that the marriage this is a spiritual relationship.
Yes,
I mean,
right.
God likens the marriage to the Lord Jesus and the church. So this is not some small deal. This is a huge deal. So as we do that, as we focus on our first love, and I think about that, man, you know, I would drive ungodly speeds to El Paso before we got married. When I was still up here, we weren't married for about 6 months, and back and forth, you know, every Saturday, as soon as we could close. I mean, I'm driving like a madman to get to El Paso, and then leave, you know, dark 30 on Sunday morning to drive back, to get back to work. You know, that should be something that you remember, just like you brought it up, as you always do, about when you're first dating. Just think about that. Yeah. Yeah. Just think about that. Listen, your relationship's more valuable than it was then.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, you've come too far to let your time together not be producing exponentially. You have children. Many of you have children. Some of them older, some of them younger. But the bottom line is, you've got a perfect opportunity now to lay groundwork for them as they grow. I mean, we don't know how long it's going to be before the Lord Jesus comes back. But you know what? It would be wonderful for us to find that spark that we had. Yes, you're different, you're older, there are going to be some differences in that, but the bottom line, there's still going to be an affection.
Amen.
There's
That's
still
right.
going to be, I'm excited to hear your voice, how's it going, babe? What's happening, you know? And help each other, you know? There are days when, you know, you don't have the brightest day ever, but we're faith people, we know that God can fix all of those things, but if we encourage each other, when we run into issues like that, you know, as opposed to acting as if it's bothering us, or that we've got something more important to do, I guarantee you, you'd have anything more to do when you were chasing her, you guys.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
I mean, you had a goal in mind.
Yeah, that conquer mentality.
Yeah.
And there was plenty of time invested.
You would invest as much time as necessary until the conquering was conquered, and then you would just want more of that conquering.
Right, and it still takes time, and it still takes work. It takes a commitment to each other to continue to do this.
And I'm not trying to make this base. I'm not trying to make this base or lewd or just about our sexual relationship. This is about the fact you talked for hours.
Yeah.
With no guarantees about nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Huh? You knew nothing up front, huh?
Yeah.
But there was a connection there, and you were willing to do whatever it takes.
Yes.
It's time to get back to that.
It's time to determine that you're going to meet that other person's needs.
Yeah.
Well, in order to find out what their needs are, you got to communicate. And that's what's so important. You know, God is our ultimate need meter.
Yes.
We know that, and our marriage will be better and the way God designed it if both husband and wife have a relationship with the Father. And then as they come together, Matthew 6:33, they're seeking first the kingdom.
Thank
and
you,
all
Lord.
These other things will be added unto them. So that's so important. But it takes time and it takes effort. And think about it. You know, it takes the time that you could be playing your video game or watching your favorite football game. I think your relationship,
or going to pick up your breakfast burrito,
I think your relationship with your spouse is more important than that.
Yeah.
Now, what you have to do, and I've suggested some things on here that you need to have conversation, and this is the way you don't do it. Honey, we need to talk. And then honey says, what do you want to talk about? Now, that's a wrong answer. That's a wrong answer. You know, you need to know and know the other person and be sensitive to their needs. And so I've even given you some things to ask, conversation starters, so you can communicate with each other's needs. Because what happens is, and this is probably can be played out in every marriage, the husband gets home from work, how was your day? It was good. And that's the end of the conversation.
Yeah.
Well, we need more information than that. Like, why was it good? What was good about your day? What can I help you with? You know, have conversation, because your wife wants to know about your world, and you should want to know about her world.
Remember, you used to want to know.
Yeah, you used to want to know. So, without this communication, without being sensitive to the other person's needs, listen, they're going to find somebody who's going to listen to them.
Good.
Do you understand that? They're going to find somebody else who's going to say, oh, what did you do today, honey? Tell me about the kids. You see, they're going to find somebody else. So you want to be that one that they communicate with. And so let's begin to communicate one with another. Like another thing I've said on here is, what made you feel bad today? It didn't go right today? Tell me about it. What went wrong today? Oh, that boss, he was a big pain in the butt. Okay, well, let's pray for that boss. You see, have some communication. You know, Ed Cole said that when couples get together at the end of the day, they should sit down and they should spend a little time. This would count to your 15 hours. Spend a little time discussing some things over a Perrier, he said, where you just relax and you discuss these things and you get in that mode of, yes, I love you and I care about your day. What happens is you come home from work, everybody's so busy, there's no communication. And so that's not right. You need to find out what you need. What can I do to satisfy your needs? Breakfast. I wrote it down. Breakfast and dinner. Breakfast, so I got that down. And what am I doing right? Am I doing things correctly or am I not? And this is what is so important, that if she says or he says something that kind of, don't get butt hurt.
Yeah.
Like, just do it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's worth it. For you to make some adjustments and some changes. So I'm willing to breakfast and dinner. Okay. I'm willing to do that, honey. If you're going to eat it, I'm going to fix it. But when you have conversation, you talk about your likes and your dislikes. And don't be ugly. And be honest and forthright. Listen, if there's not trust and honesty in a relationship, you got a problem.
Now, you know, that could be one thing. That's totally different when you're first dating. You are
lying,
masking.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to tell them a lot of things, but a lot of things you aren't, because you don't want to jeopardize, you know, the chance of maybe having another date. And so
I was perfectly honest. He did not tell me about all the bills that he had. I would advise anybody in a dating position, get their tax returns before you say I do. Check it out. See how many bills they have. So you, not these guys, they may not have lied.
I was going to share that, sweetheart. I have in the past. I've shared that.
It wasn't shared until
after
we were married and I got all the payment books.
I'm not shady anymore. Okay.
I was
trying to work my way out of alcoholism and the car business.
Okay. Another thing that's going to help in your marriage relationship is too many couples have their own separate interest. Like, she has all of her interest, he has all of his interest, and they don't collide. So, and they don't care. That's why they're incompatible, so to speak. They don't share anything. And that's why it's important for the man to take an interest. Like, Pastor Dean will occasionally watch a Hallmark movie, and I will go to a baseball game, even though I don't really care for baseball. But you make concessions. And then you determined to do something together, whether it's golfing or gardening or whatever. You do something together so you have common interest. What are you thinking?
No, I was just going to say something.
Okay, well, don't say that.
No, so, I'm not going to say that. Here's what I'm going to say. I'm going to say this because this is important that I say this. This is a spiritual house.
Amen.
Every one of you is on a spiritual level.
Yes.
Probably most of you are on a higher spiritual level than you even give yourself credit for.
Yeah, that's good.
And because of that, that can be something that you actually allow yourselves to, as a couple, to begin to talk about together.
Yeah.
Since none of us have arrived, neither one of us in the couples represented in the room have arrived.
That's right.
So this is a great place to be open about where we are in our relationship, as a man, as a woman, either one, to not be intimidated. But this gives you the greatest ground to have commonality. This is the perfect place for you to begin to find a place of communication that's the same for both of you. And when you realize that, then you'll begin to find out that your relationship, first and foremost, around the word, is going to be the thing that strengthens that relationship.
Right.
And then should there be other things that are not necessary, or you begin to realize are really not something that mean that much to you anyway, then it's going to draw you back to the thing that makes the most difference. Most Christians never find out how big a deal it is to have the Word of God as the focus of their life. We've got a captive audience tonight. And so you need to, as you always do here in this house, when you focus on the Word of God, and then if you'll focus on it together, huh? You know, don't be creepy. Don't feel inferior, guys or gals, either one. Because God will bring the two of you together to a place. Because if He's got couples like you that are willing to love Him and love each other together in both of those focuses, then He's going to be able to take you and use you in the rest of your marriage in a supernatural way. And all I'm saying is this: this word is the same for each one of us.
That's right.
Huh? Which means that we can grow together in our knowledge of the Word of God and the plan of God. We still enjoy the other things that we enjoy, our hunting, our fishing, whatever it happens to be, a little time on the video games, whatever you can learn to do that doesn't interfere with what's important.
Right.
Which is your spouse and your children and your church activity, all under the banner of God's plan.
Amen.
Amen.
That's what brings you together, and it brings you together for the same purpose. You know, I mean, you can't expect your spouse to be excited about stuff that maybe you're excited about. So you have to be in a position where you're loved one for another. You allow your spouse can do this. They don't take advantage of it, but they have time to do the things, to go hunting, to do this, to do that, or to do the same thing with the wife, huh? It could be the wife that's the hunter. I don't know. But here's the whole key to it. When we do this, then we become the men and women of God that He's called us to be. Our relationship will be the best. Because let me tell you something. God created everything that marriage is supposed to be, to represent. Huh? From
yes.
communication to sex to resources, all of those things. He's the creator of it. He perverted none of that. And when we begin to see ourselves as a couple in the Word of God, then He's able to grow us up together where everything we will put our hand to is prosper. We'll have the best hunting we've ever had. We'll have the best fishing we've ever had. We'll have the best whatever we've ever had. We'll fix the best breakfast we've ever fixed.
I'm going to work on that. Got any recipes? Are you finished?
Well, I need to be.
I mean, that was really good. If you'll look to the right, the next heart is emptying.
That was really good.
Emptying your love tank. Really? And I think this is important to realize that couples sometimes use conversation to punish each other.
Yeah. Mm.
And that's mental and that's emotional abuse. You know, there are certain phrases, certain things that are said, like name calling, certain things that will cause the other person to just be ticked off. Like, you know it and you keep doing it. You know it and you keep saying it. And so we don't need to get in that mode. We need to eliminate that from
exactly.
our relationship. You can't blast each other with hurtful expressions. That doesn't need to be part. That's going to empty your love tank. And our goal tonight is
in one bedroom, maybe.
Yeah. Our goal tonight is to fill our love tank,
absolutely.
Not empty it. So be aware of that. Another one is don't use conversation to force agreement in your way of thinking. This is so important because you need to sit down and get understanding. You know, whether maybe one of you is more a dominant personality and it's my way or the highway, you need to eliminate that from your relationship. You need to sit down and come to a mutual agreement. If you don't come to an agreement, then okay, let's just table this for right now. You know, instead of trying to force what you want on the other person, doesn't work that way. You have to realize, according to Matthew 18, 19.
I'm not being affectionate. I wanted to say something.
Okay.
Spiritual maturity on both of your parts will eliminate the selfishness that creates most issues. And spiritual maturity will bring you to a place where what you were once in heat for no longer means as much to you as it once did. And that's simply because you've now started working together, allowing God to actually be the center of the relationship, because that's what He's supposed to be.
Yes.
And then no longer are you thinking about you all the time. So it's a matter of getting back. It's a matter of returning to your first love is really what it is.
Well, getting back to Matthew 18, 19 and the power of agreement.
Yeah.
Think about it. There's no relationship on the earth that is as strong as a husband and wife. They're physically united. And then when they're spiritually and mentally and, you know, in, take this covenant seriously. And it says if two agree as touching anything that they shall ask in Matthew 18, 19, it shall be done of my Father in heaven. So think about how powerful that is to be in agreement, not disagreement. Do you understand? So we've got to be in agreement with our spouse. Another thing that will empty our love tank is dwelling on the mistakes of the past or the present. Yeah. Now, you can discuss the present mistakes, but you know, some of these things you just need to forget.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
The past mistakes, if you keep bringing them up, you're headed down the wrong road.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. What does God do with our mistakes? When we repent, when we go to Him and we ask Him for forgiveness and we truly mean it, then what does He do? He forgives and He forgets. And the Bible says He removes our sin as far as the east is from the west.
Amen.
And He remembers it no more. Should we remember our spouse's faults and the past, the things that they've done in the past? No. No, you can't keep bringing them up. You've got to look to the future, and you want your future to be bright. And so you keep digging up the crap from the past. It's just like peeling off a scab. It's not going to heal. So you forget those things that are past and move on and have some discussion about it.
And let me, you know, I feel as if I really need to mention this as it pertains to things that have been done wrong. If you have if there's been betrayal or anything in the relationship, don't expect your spouse to free you of the consequences that has created. But that doesn't mean, as you say, you don't bring that up, hold that to them for the rest of their life. They need to be forgiven. But the party that's had the issue needs to understand, and understand clearly, huh? That they have a responsibility. There were consequences to what they did.
Right.
And they can't bully their way back in to the relationship as it once was. Faith and trust has to be reestablished. That has to be reestablished. You know, the Bible talks about forgiveness, and the Bible requires change for there to be forgiveness. So there needs to be an understanding that each of us deserve the honesty of one another and the willingness of one another to move forward, but at the pace that will restore that relationship where we don't have that scab for decades.
Exactly.
We move forward. And as trust is reestablished, then that can be easily done. Because listen, back to your first love, that was the love that started this relationship. And that is the love that will restore the relationship. So you're wanting to get back to that, which means you have a responsibility to be right in your position as the spouse, whether male or female.
Right.
it's important that we understand. We don't just do what we want to do and expect our wife or our husband to just continue on without any reestablishment of trust.
So there's some other conversation tips that are down below that will help you. You know, in counseling with women, many of them say, well, my husband just won't say anything. He just won't talk. Or it could be the other way around. Maybe. I don't know of a woman who doesn't talk. But
I was going to say, yeah.
If that's the case.
Does she fix breakfast?
From now on, I will, honey. So what I'm saying is, if your husband doesn't talk, he won't talk to you, then what you do is when he's around his buddies and when he's around his friends, you listen to what he's talking about, and then you begin talking about what he likes to talk about. You know, and most people really like to talk about themselves or their hunting or their guns or whatever. So you pick a topic that he's interested in, and
sweetheart,
he'll talk.
You're amazing.
He'll talk.
Pretty,
And see, one of the things that you have to do in relationships is you have to, timing is everything. Do you understand that? I mean, if you've been married more than a month, you know that. Like, there are times that you can talk about things and there are times that you can't talk about things. And there are certain questions that you can ask, but you have to ask it in a certain way.
Isn't that funny that that list has changed since you were dating?
Yeah, it really has. And so what you've got to do is you've got to ask the Holy Spirit to help you in your communication with your spouse. And He will. He will help you. And one of the things that's so important is to set aside some time in your 15 hours to talk. And if you've got a spouse who doesn't talk, okay, now this is your turn to talk. You get to talk 10 minutes and set a timer. And initially, I mean, really, there are some men that probably couldn't talk 10 minutes. But I mean, what you've got to do is it's a balance. Like, you talk and then he talks. And then you talk and he talks. And if he keeps interrupting, then there's a problem here. See, a lot of you sanguines.
Yeah, you need to change what you're talking about. You need to be more interesting about your conversation, because we just have to, you know, are you finished with this? You know, because how many minutes has it been, sweetheart?
No, that's not right. And you know that. You know that's not right. You have to take an interest in the other person and not interrupt. And that's why if you set a timer, then the spouse who talks a lot won't talk the whole time. You'll have equal, it'll be balanced. You can't interrupt.
Are you fronting me? Or what?
No, no.
Okay, just kidding.
Okay, another thing is use your conversation to inform, investigate, IIU. Inform, investigate, and understand. Inform, investigate, and understand. And what you want to do is create emotional closeness, because it's so important that you grow together, not apart. Yeah. My first marriage, they said, why are you getting a divorce? Incompatibility. I didn't even know what it meant, but it sounded good. But we just didn't get along.
Didn't know,
you know
the definition.
Because I was going my way, he was going his way. And that's what the divorce counselor said. You've grown apart.
And I showed
apart.
Up just in time to head in her direction.
Yeah, he did.
Whee!
Another thing in this conversation, you have to open up. You have to open up. You have to open up. And a husband won't open up to a wife if he can't trust her, if she's telling her mom and everybody else what he said. So that's ridiculous. So be respectful for the other person's opinion. You know, if you don't like their opinion, you think it's stupid, you don't tell them that that's a stupid opinion. Then you'll never have that conversation that's open and caring and loving. Yeah, it won't be there. Okay. Another thing that will help you in your communication is find out what makes them happy and what makes them sad. And I know I've got breakfast on here. Honey, just quit pointing to that. The thing about it is, it's important through these 15 hours to give each other undivided attention. Because after all, they are the most important person in
Absolutely.
Your life, besides the father. Yeah.
Absolutely.
They don't need to feel like they're in competition with their kids. So you have to make time. You have to make time for your 15 hours. And I believe you will make time for your 15 hours because you want to have caring conversations. Now, your words have power, and so throughout, all around the hearts, are scriptures from Proverbs, scriptures from other parts of the Bible that are in different translations that will help you understand how important your words are. Basically, you want to speak life. Life and death is in the power of the tongue. So you want to speak life at all times, not death. Not death about your husband or your wife, to your friends at work or your coworkers or your mom or whoever. You want to always be speaking life. Just like my mother used to say, if you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all.
Who said that?
My mother. I know she did have a few wise things to say, honey.
It's probably first before I met her.
Praise the Lord. So, honey, do you want to have anything else to say?
I'm really encouraged.
Good. I'm glad.
I am. I mean, seriously, I'm really encouraged. I was encouraged in the spirit, thinking about this opportunity tonight. I was thinking about the supernatural things that I believe are beginning to occur in the lives of the people of Choose Life. Obviously, those that are married have a tremendous opportunity to make a big impact on their world. And I'm just excited. I'm excited to be a part of that. And I don't want us to make it difficult. I don't want you to think for a minute that that God isn't able to fix every area.
Amen.
That you come up against, every area. It doesn't make any difference what it is. If you'll keep your heart right as it pertains to the Word of God and your responsibility as the husband or the wife, then things are going to begin to flow like never before. Like it hasn't happened a lot. There have not really been a lot of people that are really close to God's heart as it pertains in the entirety of their relationship, marriage relationship, their children, their work, everything they do, because it's a package to God. Spirit, soul, and body is what He's looking at.
Yes.
And He expects every area to be a reflection of His goodness. And I believe that we have a very unique opportunity here. Those of you that I know as well as I know, you've experienced many miracles in your life and have been drawn together. You've found yourself with husbands or wives that you can work with, you can play with, you can enjoy life with, and you can honor God with. And because of that, God has a special opportunity for each and every one of you. So whatever it takes to set aside your, and there's really nothing more to it than selfishness. Setting aside your selfishness.
That's right.
To be the very best husband or the very best wife you can be, you have to set those things aside. And the moment you do that, God will remove from your consciousness anything you've set aside, and He'll replace it with things that prove to be more beneficial to you than you ever thought possible.
Yes,
that's
amen.
Walking by faith.
Yes.
Walking by faith is realizing that the things that I do naturally or carnally or in the sense realm need to be things that God wants me to do. Because when that's the case, every relationship I have with my spouse, with my children, with my boss, with my employees, however or whatever the relationship is going to be the very best. And that's what we're expecting. We're not expecting a deficit. We're expecting a profit in everything we put our hands to. And we can do that because our God is able to do exceeding,
yes, amen,
abundantly above anything we ask or think.
Yes.
He's able to do that, but He's only able to do that when we allow the power of His Word to fill us to the point where we begin to allow it to be released in every area of
amen.
Our life. Amen.
I climb every mountain, swim every ocean, just to be with you.